12 months and counting, interest rates rise again. The base rate has now hit 4.5% for the first time since 2008. The bad news for some mortgage payers came with more bad news for everyone. The Bank of England says inflation is expected to fall slower than previously thought. Also ahead. The DCI bank star cleared of GBH after he confronted two men outside his house. The train service being nationalised. It's the end of the line for First Group's TransPennine Express after months of delays and cancellations.
Three of my four trains every hour are TransPennine and it gets delayed or cancelled every day.
I think it's really good that it's been taken away.
And the Taylor Swift effect, how a book that may or may not be the star's memoirs has topped the charts thanks to her fans and social media.
This is the ITV Lunchtime News with Nina Hussain.
Good afternoon. Interest rates have risen to their highest level in nearly 15 years as the Bank of England warned inflation is expected to fall at a slower rate than previously thought. The decision to put up rates to 4.5% was not unanimous. Two of the seven members of the bank's Monetary Policy Committee wanted to keep the rates unchanged. Bad news for some borrowers and the bank. Inflation is nowhere near its 2% target and still isn't in single figures, unlike America and in the Eurozone. Our political correspondent Libby Wiener has the details and reaction.
For homeowners and those dreaming of becoming one, another blow today. Mortgage rates are set to rise again as the Bank of England grapples with inflation, the governor saying it's not coming down quickly enough.
Let me be clear, inflation remains too high, and it's our job to get it all the way down to the 2% target and have it stay there. And this is why today we've increased bank rate by 0.25 percentage points to 4.5%. Low and stable inflation is the foundation of a healthy economy, and we have to stay the course to make sure inflation falls all the way back to the 2% target.
On an average tracker mortgage of £113,000, today's hike means you will be paying an extra £24 a month. Overall, since rates began rising, the monthly payment has gone up by £417. Nearly 1.4 million borrowers coming off fixed-rate mortgages are also in for a shock. In 2019, the average fixed rate was 2.5%, but is now more than 5%.
We've got a brand new kitchen. All fitted out, ready to go.
In Burnley, one bakery had high hopes of expanding, but is now having to close its premises, its owner unable to afford the mortgage.
At the age of 28, I'm now moving back in with my mum and dad. This time last year, my mortgage was £513. Mm. Right now, it's £640, which is a massive increase. Teamed with the increase in our ingredients, it's just making business less viable.
Rising food prices are being blamed for the fact inflation is still stubbornly high. Labour says the government has failed to deal with the cost of living crisis.
Today will be a day of great anxiety for many families and businesses around the country who are facing the 12th increase in interest rates in just a matter of months. That means higher mortgage costs. Already, people have paid £1 billion more in mortgage repayments compared to where they would have been 6 months ago.
Some mortgage advisers also say they're surprised and frustrated that the Bank of England has raised rates yet again.
And Libby, inflation, according to the Bank of England today, is expected to fall slower than previously thought now.
Yes, that is the basic problem. The government is committed to halving inflation by the end of the year, one of Rishi Sunak's five promises, you might remember. But with food prices still running at a very high rate indeed, they are way off target. Now, the Chancellor, Jeremy Hunt, who's in Japan for a G7 summit of economic ministers, said the news was disappointing for families with mortgages. I have to say, I think it'd be disappointing for people who are renting as well, because rents are likely to go up too if mortgages are going up. Now, the Monetary Policy Committee was divided on this interest rate rise. Two members thought that actually interest rates should stay unchanged. But you heard the governor, Andrew Bailey, there. He clearly does think that there needs to be more pain in order to get inflation down.
Libby Wiener, thank you very much. Thank you. The actor Stephen Tomkinson was today cleared of inflicting grievous bodily harm on a man he confronted outside his house in Whitley Bay. The confrontation happened in the early hours of the morning in May 2021 when the DCI Bank star was on the phone to the police to report two men making strange noises. One of the men fell to the ground and broke his skull. It took the jury just under 2 hours to find the actor not guilty. Faye Barker has the details.
Leaving court today, Stephen Tomkinson was cleared of inflicting grievous bodily harm on a man he confronted for drunkenly making noises outside his house 2 years ago.
Have you got anything to say to the carpool?
Making no comment, the actor was keen to just get home. Newcastle Crown Court had heard that this man, Carl Paul, and a friend had been drinking since midnight and had passed the actor's home in Whitley Bay at about 5:30 a.m. Hearing noises, Mr. Tomkinson called the police.
I've got two incapable elf drunks. One of them's just in his underwear. They can't stand. There's a bottle of Jägermeister between them. I've just taken off them. I've asked them to move. They can't move.
A neighbour told the court Mr. Tomkinson had struck Mr. Paul, who fell backwards and hit his head, causing brain injuries. The actor, however, said he'd put his hand out to stop the man moving towards him.
Still got it.
Well known for the title role in ITV drama DCI Banks, Stephen Tomkinson has been a popular actor since the 1990s, when he also starred in Drop the Dead Donkey.
Behind me, painstaking barons burning lead drug soldiers in huge piles of whale nets.
Films include Brassed Off, and he is also an accomplished stage actor.
They told me to stop displaying the signs.
All this, though, he told the court, had been put on hold while the case hung over him, claiming he'd lost acting work because of it. Now cleared of this offence, the actor will be hoping it's one drama he can put behind him. Faye Barker, ITV News.
TransPennine Express has lost its contract to run train services. The company, owned by First Group, runs intercity trains across the north of England and into Scotland, but no more. At the end of this month, the services will be nationalised after months of delays and cancellations. Ben Chapman is at Leeds train station. Ben, many frustrated passengers and some politicians have welcomed this announcement today.
Yes, this is the announcement that tens of thousands of rail passengers across the north of England have quite literally been waiting for. They've had to endure months of delayed and cancelled trains. Commuters have had to put up with trains being cancelled late at night for the following morning. In March, one in six first TransPennine Express trains were cancelled. In January and February, it was even worse. It was closer to one in four. Now, the company has blamed high staff sickness rates, a training backlog, a disagreement with the drivers' union about overtime. But today, the Transport Secretary said enough was enough. The company is being stripped of its contract. It won't be renewed when it expires towards the end of this month. Instead, the service will be brought under government control. It's been welcomed by the elected mayors here in Leeds and also in Greater Manchester and by passengers on this platform.
To be honest, I'm more interested in whoever can offer reliability rather than the brand name.
Three of my four trains every hour are TransPennine and it gets delayed or cancelled every day. And it's pathetic.
I'm constantly stressed about whether I'm going to get home or, you know, whether I'm going to get on another service. I just think it's really good that it's been taken away.
Well, this is now the fourth rail service in England to be taken under government control, along with LNER, Northern and South Eastern, as well as train services in Scotland, Wales and Northern Ireland. Labour today criticised what they called the endless cycle of shambolic private operators failing passengers and said they would nationalise all rail services. The Transport Secretary also admitted today that this nationalisation is not a silver bullet and won't instantaneously fix the service. Passengers will be waiting to find out if it improves.
Ben Chapman, thank you. Still to come, Trump's bizarre and outlandish claims just days after his sexual assault verdict. And the Swift effect, why a book flew to the top of the charts. First, at the start of the year, the Prime Minister Rishi Sunak pledged that NHS waiting lists will fall and people would get the care they need more quickly. The latest figures out today show so far that hasn't happened. 7.3 million people were waiting for NHS treatment in England in March, up from 7.2 million in February. Charlie Frost on the growing NHS backlog.
Stuck in chronic pain, which is triggering depression. 42-year-old Jessica has endometriosis. She's been waiting for a hysterectomy for 3 years.
At times, to be honest, I've felt suicidal. That there's no end in sight. It's constant pain. It's a constant circle.
Jessica's turmoil is mirrored across the country. In February, 7.2 million people in England were waiting to start routine hospital treatment. That rose to 7.3 million in March, the highest number since records began. But while the number of people waiting has risen, the length of time they're waiting for is reducing. In February, nearly 30,000 people had been waiting for more than 18 months. That fell to just over 10,500 in March. A significant reduction, but not enough to meet the government's April target of eliminating all waits of more than a year and a half. And the new record high in the overall backlog hasn't been helped by recent staff strikes. Industrial action postponed more than 500,000 appointments in the last 5 months. And while the majority of unions accepted the government's latest pay offer, it still doesn't address all staffing issues.
For surgery to carry on, it needs a whole surgical team. So it's surgeons, anaesthetists, all the support staff, both in the theatre and in the wards, particularly in critical care wards, for example. And unless we have enough of those staff, we won't be able to see an increase in capacity that will allow the waiting list to be brought down.
The government says it is delivering, making progress on its ambitious targets. But for patients in pain like Jessica, the progress isn't fast enough. Charlie Frost, ITV News.
The Welsh Nationalist Party, Plaid Cymru, has announced it has a new interim leader after Adam Price quit over a damning report which found misogyny, harassment and bullying in the party. Wales's political editor Adrian Masters is at the Senedd in Cardiff. Adrian, why is the party in such turmoil at the moment?
Nina, it really is in turmoil. This for Plaid Cymru is a bad situation that has been badly handled, and the reasons behind it are difficult and painful. And I don't just mean that at a political level, because the report that you mentioned that was published last week found that the party and the party leadership had failed to take seriously allegations of sexual harassment, bullying and abuse. And it had failed to deal with those complaints that it had received in a timely and successful manner. So that's incredibly difficult for members of the party that believe in its aims, which it positions itself as a progressive party. And it's very difficult for them to hear, as well as those victims who allegations and their experience. Now, last week, Adam Price apologised. He said that that mistakes had been made, but that he would carry on as leader, that he would see the party through this difficult period. It quickly became apparent over the last few days that that was an unsustainable position and that he didn't have the support of Senedd members, of Plaid Cymru members here in the Senedd. So it's politically damaging to Plaid Cymru, but there's more to this. Plaid Cymru is the third largest party in the Welsh Parliament, but it's working with the Labour Welsh Government to deliver, well, quite a lot of policies, including free school meals to all primary school children. That is now under question. So the political turmoil in one party, Plaid Cymru, is just beginning to affect all of Welsh politics.
Adrian Masters, thank you very much. Thank you. The United Kingdom is bolstering Ukraine's defences and sending Storm Shadow missiles to the country. The Defence Secretary told the Commons they will give the country the best chance to defend themselves against Russia's continued brutality. The long-range cruise missiles would allow Ukraine's forces to hit Russian troops, ammunition and fuel dumps deep behind the front line. Ukraine has been asking for them for months. Donald Trump was cheered by a Republican-friendly TV audience in America last night as he made a series of outlandish and fake claims. He verbally attacked the woman who successfully sued him for sexual assault. He repeated the false claims that the last presidential election had been stolen. And he hinted he would pardon many of the Capitol Hill rioters if he gets re-elected. Our correspondent Robert Moore was watching.
Just 30 hours after a jury had found Donald Trump liable for sexual assault.
Please welcome the frontrunner for the Republican nomination, former President Donald Trump.
And the former president took to the stage for a CNN-hosted conversation with voters. And in front of this Republican-leaning audience, he was cheered and applauded. Attacking his accuser.
What kind of a woman meets somebody and brings him up, and within minutes, you're playing hanky-panky in a dressing room, OK?
Insisting it was all part of a conspiracy against him.
This is a fake story, made-up story. We had a horrible Clinton-appointed judge. He was horrible. He allowed her to put everything in. He allowed us to put nothing in.
And he repeated multiple times his false and entirely discredited claim that the 2020 election had been stolen.
And when you look at what happened during that election, unless you're a very stupid person, you see what happened. Most people understand what happened. That was a rigged election, and it's a shame that we had to go through it. It's very bad for our country. All over the world, they looked at it.
He was asked about the infamous moment on January the 6th, when he appeared before a crowd just before they marched on the Capitol.
USA! They were there proud. They were there with love in their heart.
And he then broadly hinted that if he won the presidency again,
stop the steal! Stop the steal!
He would pardon many of the rioters.
My answer is, I am most likely, if I get in, I will most likely, I would say it will be a large portion of them.
Outlandishly, Trump claimed he would be able to instantly end the Ukraine war.
If I'm president, I will have that war settled in one day, 24 hours.
He refused to commit himself to saying he wanted Ukraine to win.
I want everybody to stop dying. They're dying, Russians and Ukrainians. I want them to stop dying.
And claimed it was unfair that America was providing the bulk of the support to Ukraine.
This. I want Europe to put up more money because they're in for $20 billion, we're in for $170
and
they should
be,
and they should equalize. They have plenty of money. They should equalize.
This was such a polarizing performance.
I would like for you to answer the question.
Okay, it's very simple to answer.
That's why I asked it.
It's very simple to, you're a nasty person, I'll tell you.
It may encourage other Republicans to run against him. The governor of Florida is one such contender.
We the people are not destined for failure.
He has already launched campaign ads against Trump.
Ron DeSantis is likely to enter the fray within the next few weeks, hoping that Donald Trump is fatally damaged and creating an opportunity for another populist to seize the reins of the Republican Party. Robert Moore, ITV News, Washington.
Back here, the Duchess of Edinburgh has said her heartfelt thoughts are with the family of a woman hit by a police motorcycle escorting the royal. It happened while the Duchess was travelling through London yesterday afternoon. The woman, who is in her 80s, remains in a critical condition. Two Metropolitan Police officers have been sacked for punching and kicking a 14-year-old boy before lying in their statements. The police constables were accused of using excessive force on the teenager in North London in April 2023. And a far-right extremist who blew up his family kitchen while making explosives has been sentenced to 8.5 years in a young offenders institution. Vaughan Dolphin, who's 20 and from Walsall, was convicted last month of terrorism offences. Finally, this lunchtime, to the strange tale of Taylor Swift's latest chart topper. It's not her new song or album, but a book. Her fans believe the yet-to-be-published non-fiction title is her memoir. So the rumour across social media has turned it into a bestseller. Andrew Misra on the lyricist who may or may not be turning to literature. It's me.
Taylor Swift's songwritings earned her a string of chart-topping hits, but is she about to release a different type of number one? An upcoming book by an unannounced author has shot to the top of pre-order charts in the US, powered by social media speculation that it could be Taylor's memoirs.
It is 544 pages long, 5 plus 4 plus 4 equals 13.
Known to be Swift's lucky number.
It is not a political memoir. However, Flatiron Books does a lot of political memoirs, including Joe Biden, Oprah Winfrey. So it seems like they're used to working with big names.
The book comes out on the 9th of July. Ran off the plane that July 9th, Meteor Hall. A date referred to in Taylor's 2010 song Last Kiss. And in her recent Instagram post. Some booksellers even seem convinced, offering to return the $45 price tag if it doesn't turn out to be Swift's book. Entertainment magazine Variety says it isn't, but eager fans are unlikely to give up hope until they get word from the star herself. Andrew Mesra, ITV News.
That's it. Bye-bye.